My name is Amir Sarwardi. Welcome. I'm assuming everyone is here for the Shakespeare's Whistleblowers event. First of all, thank you very, very, very much for coming. I want to thank a couple of people before we begin. I want to, first of all, begin by thanking the technical staff that has helped us put today's event together. Kevin Brandley, Mary Granahan, and her staff that are helping to record this event, and we'll make it available to some of our local high schoolers as well. And I'd like to thank all of you for coming. Also, Dr. Henry Jackson for coordinating with some of our local high schoolers as well. I believe they should be here, but if they're not, anyway. All of you are here, and so today's event is called Shakespeare's Whistleblowers, Ladies First. We have a pretty packed event, and we're going to try and finish right at 12:15. I know some of you have classes to get to at 12:30. I do too as well, so we're going to try and keep everything on schedule. So the goal today is for us to talk about Shakespeare, and to talk about discrimination and harassment in the workplace. That's the thing we're going to focus in on today. I will show you some scenes from one of Shakespeare's plays, All's Well That Ends Well. It's actually an original production of the play that we put on at the Grunin Center. So we recruited actors, Broadway and off-Broadway actors. We staged the whole event together, and so you're going to get something that's really unique and original, something you won't find anywhere else except here today. So the plan is for us to have the presentation until 12 o'clock, and then to spend the last 15 minutes having a Q&A session. As you can see over there, there's a microphone right over there, and I hope that you'll have lots of questions and comments on today's presentation. Just to let you know, we do have a Twitter feed right now that's available, so if you'd like to take your phone out, or if you'd like to go to Twitter, you have a Twitter account, please feel free to tweet your thoughts or your ideas during today's event or at the end of today's event. That is the handle, ShakesW2022. So again, if questions come up or comments come up along the way, please do go to Twitter and please do put them there. And at the end of the event, I will ask for people to come up and use the microphone and voice their comments and their questions. And you can use Twitter to do the same thing as well. So again, I'd like to use those last 15 minutes just to hear from you. Today's supposed to be a conversation, not a lecture. And hopefully it'll be interesting. I do also have a prize to give at the end of today's event. So anybody who comes up with the best question or the best comment will get a door prize, I guess you could call it. So walk away with something. So keep that in mind. Keep those questions in mind as our event goes forward. So let's talk a little bit about harassment and discrimination, a subject that unfortunately is very, very prevalent in today's society, something that's particularly prevalent in the workplace, and that's really what we're going to focus in on today. Now, Shakespeare's play, the play we're going to look at today, doesn't deal with the workplace at all. It actually deals with harassment within the personal sphere, within relationships, within a marriage particularly. And so one of the things that I'll ask you to think about is, what are the connections between our world today, harassment and discrimination in our world today in 2022 in the workplace, and Shakespeare's play? What kind of ideas does Shakespeare present in his play that maybe we can transfer over into our world, into our situation? So I want you to think that way. So don't be too scared or intimidated by the Shakespeare. The Shakespeare is really there for us to start to begin thinking about our own world, our own situation. Shakespeare's got a lot of interesting ideas, and we'll go through the play and I'll explain the play, and so you needn't be intimidated by the idea that it's Shakespeare and you won't understand the language. You'll understand everything perfectly fine. So let's begin, if we can. It's over here. So if you filled out the poll, let's take a look at the poll, and let's see what you came up with. So the first question that I asked you in the poll was, what is the main reason why male job applicants get hired more often than female applicants? And so these were the choices that were available to you, those of you who didn't take the poll. What's the reason why more men get hired for jobs than women? So here were some options for you. Men are more qualified than women. More men apply for those jobs and so have a better chance of getting them. Discrimination against women during the resume reviewing process. Discrimination against women during the interviewing process. Men have better job-related connections or other. And again, feel free to use Twitter to if you selected other and you'd like to suggest other reasons why men get hired more often than women, feel free to use Twitter to put that in. Let's take a look at the results of this poll and see what most of you thought was the reason why more men get hired. So, according to your results, it's interesting. The winner here was discrimination against women, choice D,
over here. Discrimination against women during the interviewing process. More of you thought that more women didn't get hired because they couldn't get past the first interview than any other reason. 22% of you thought that it was discrimination against women during the resume reviewing process. And then in third place, there were others. Actually, in third place, you also had B as well, which is more men apply for these jobs. And so these are three of the things that we're going to talk about in today's presentation, is how can we make the process of applying for a job more equitable? How can we make the interviewing process more equitable? How can we make the promotions process more equitable? And we'll think about equitability as we're looking at Shakespeare's play. So we'll keep those things in mind. Those are the causes that you identified. The second question that I asked was, what would you say is the, The second question was, and I'll give you a chance to respond to this poll as well, what would you say is the primary reason for discrimination against women in the workplace? So once women get the job, once they're in the workplace, once they've been hired already, what do you think is the reason why they are discriminated against while they're there in the workplace? So take a minute or so to respond to that, what you think is the most important reason, or the primary reason. I'll give you maybe a minute or so to respond to that, and then I'll reveal the results of the poll. And the choices, again, are most companies have more male supervisors than female ones. Human resources departments don't do enough to deter discrimination. Men find women threatening, especially in the workplace. The way that women behave or dress. Women are afraid of speaking up or being labeled difficult or other. Which of these factors do you think is the primary reason for discrimination? And let's see here. Give you another minute, and then we'll show you the results of this poll. And then I'll share some statistics with you, things that are relevant to our world, and then we'll transition into the Shakespeare, and I'll explain to you exactly what you're going to see as far as the Shakespeare play is concerned, and then we'll run the play, we'll watch the film, and we'll comment on the film as the film kind of unspools. So here are the results of the poll. Here's what you came up with. most of you did not respond, but those of you who did respond, E was a popular choice. Women are afraid of speaking up. That's something we will definitely talk about today. One reason why there's discrimination is that women are afraid of speaking up. Silence is one of the biggest enemies. In second place was the fact that HR departments don't do enough to deter discrimination. That point of view is connected to the hiring process question as well, right? And then some of you also said that men find women threatening, especially in the workplace. So again, all of these issues that you've identified as possible reasons why women don't get hired, or once they do get hired, they get discriminated against, the Shakespeare play will get us thinking about exactly these very issues. So let me share with you a couple of things before we get to the movie itself. Let's open this up here. So, just some statistics for you. I don't know if you can make this out. I'll make it a little bit bigger. Let me get a little bit bigger. Full screen. Okay. You can see it off of here, right? Outline view. So, go to the next one. According to the CDC, the Center for Disease Control's National Intimate Partner and Sexual Violence Survey, which was conducted in 2009, every year, 1.3 million women are raped or assaulted in the United States. Of these, 81% will experience significant long-term or short-term mental health impacts, including PTSD, those associated with PTSD. Of these survivors of assault or rape, only 5% will report the crime to the proper authorities. That's a scary figure, isn't it? Only 5% will report it, which makes this the lowest ranked reported crime occurring in America today. So as you can see, it's a major problem, right? It's the lowest ranked crime which occurs with such great frequency. And of the perpetrators, 99% of them are male. And so this is obviously an issue. It's not just strictly a question of male perpetrators, but it's also a question of the fact that a lot of the times when these when these crimes take place, a lot of the people who are watching these crimes are bystanders or witnesses who also happen to be male. They often don't come forward and they often don't assist, right? And so we'll talk about all of those things. So again, it's a major problem. It's a prevalent problem. One reason why it stays a problem is that at many companies, a third of all American companies, as a matter of fact, employees are bound by what are called NDAs. You must have heard of these, non-disclosure agreements. In the case against Roger Ailes at Fox News, Gretchen Carlson was bound by a non-disclosure agreement, as a result of which she settled her harassment lawsuit quietly, and she could not talk about it in public or to the press because she had signed this NDA. And so we'll talk about the ways in which crimes are often masked, but victims and their grievances are not allowed to see the light of day. Corporations will often force arbitration through the courts or else offer token compensation in exchange for signing NDAs, non-disclosure agreements. And so what are some ways in which to bring these voices forward, to give victims allies, and to give victims a safe space within which they can share and receive the support that they need? These are some of the issues that we will we'll think about today. I know there's a lot of information here, but basically this slide talks about the difference between how men are hired at companies and how women are hired. And so let me point out a couple of things. The McKinsey company, which does reports every year, issues a report every year called the Women in the Workplace Report. They found in 2012, they did a survey of more than 333 organizations, more than 12 million people were employed, and what they found was that for every 100 men who were promoted from entry-level roles to manager positions, only 87 were women. So in other words, for every 100 men who were promoted, only 87 women were promoted. And only 82 of those women were women of color. And so there's a great deal of disparity within corporate America, and you can see some of the discrimination that's there. According to a study conducted by the Yale School of Management, women were 14% less likely annually to be promoted at one of the largest retail chains in America. And so even after they're hired, even after they make their way into the company, they don't very often get a chance to get promoted within that company. And it's interesting, right? Because usually you might think it has something to do with their performance, that they don't perform as well, and that's why they don't get promoted. But in fact, according to this study, women's performance at these companies, at this largest retail chain in America, women's performance actually was rated higher than men's performance. So how could we explain the fact that they're not getting promoted if their performance ratings are higher on average? But interestingly enough, these women were rated not only on their performance but also on their potential. So bosses rated them not only on their ability on the work that they did, but also they kind of envisaged what kind of work they would be capable of doing, their potential for success. Interestingly enough, women's potential was rated lower than men's, even though their performances were on average higher than their male counterparts. And this is a pattern that continued even when women exceeded their performance, work performance standards, their potential ratings were still lower than men. Which again, gives us pause and makes us think of in what ways can we combat these issues? Are these problems that don't have a solution, or are there solutions that perhaps we should think about more often? One sort of conclusion of this study was that one thing that happens often in companies is that promotion is based more on what's called a mirrortocracy rather than a meritocracy, right? And what does that mean? It means that the merits of an employee are not the reason why they are often hired. The merits of an employee are not always the reason why they are promoted or make it to the top. In fact, the people who are making the decisions about who gets hired, the people who are making the decisions about who gets promoted, it's their own kind of predispositions, their own kind of biases. Sometimes these are unconscious biases. You might have heard that expression before. There's a conscious bias which says that we will not hire such and such person, but there's also unconscious bias, the kind of bias that says Sarah is a great employee, but I think Bill has more potential for success in this company. There may not be a conscious bias against Sarah, but the unconscious bias may be to give Bill the promotion. And so social scientists have come up with this idea of a mirroritocracy, the idea that the successful are looking into the mirror as they promote. When a male, white, employer looks across the table at the person who he is interviewing, he wants to see somebody who looks and sounds like him and is more likely to give the job to that person and is more likely to give the promotion to that person rather than someone who does not look and sound like him, does not remind him of him. And so this is often called a mirroritocracy. People in positions of power looking for others like them to be their colleagues. And so how do we fight against this? How do we fight against this bias, which is so based on the way that a person looks? She looks different, and therefore she will not fit in. She will not fit into this culture. How to fight against this? If visual impressions are the first criteria through which people get hired and promoted, how do you fight against that? Do you tell everyone just to close their eyes? And so these are some of the questions that we'll think about as well. So what I wanted to do was, since we laid all of these questions out on the table, I wanted us to think about how Shakespeare can help us with this. What can a writer who's been dead for 400 years possibly have to teach us, right, about these issues which are so important and so pressing today? And so I wanted us to, we're gonna watch the film in a few moments, but I wanted us to think about the difference between fiction and nonfiction and what fiction kind of gives us that perhaps nonfiction doesn't give us. And so I put this slide up. Nonfiction tells us what is. So when you read reports or newspaper articles or you watch the news, you get a reporting of what is. Fiction instead proposes what if. Fiction is not bound by the rules of the world as it exists. It draws on the power of the imagination to imagine what if scenarios. What if things were different? What if scenarios were created where many of the constraints that we are now afflicted by could instead be circumvented? So I want you all to think of the power of what if. And what Shakespeare is giving us, because again, Shakespeare's play is not about employer hiring practices. It's a play about a man who pursues a woman. And so let me use that to transition then into all's well that ends well. So let me first of all show you the people who you're about to see. I'm about to run the video in just a second. And so let me show you the faces of these people who you're about to see. Can everyone make this out? Yep. Okay, so I'm going to just give you a very brief 90-second synopsis of this play. You don't need to be an expert in Shakespeare or anything like that. I'll explain to you exactly what you need to know about the play, and then we'll show the video. And as you're watching the video, I'll give you a couple of questions to think about even before I run the video, and we'll pause the video along the way, and I'll ask you questions about what you're observing. So basically, the play involves these characters, and I've put their pictures up so you will know who they are. When I run the video, you'll know exactly who they are, and I'll explain everything you're about to see, so hopefully there won't be that much confusion. And so the main characters are the King Roussillon, and then the King of Roussillon, at the beginning of the play, he's very, very sick, and there's nobody who can find a cure for the disease that ails him. And there is a woman named Helen, who is the daughter of a doctor, and she comes up with a cure that basically saves the king's life. And so the play begins with the king being enormously indebted to Helen and saying to Helen, you've saved my life. Here, let me take off my royal ring. And what he does is he takes off a ring from his finger and he hands that ring over to Helen. And he says to Helen, if ever in your life you need any help of any sort, show whoever you need help from this ring. Let them know this is the king's ring, and that ring will get you answers to any problem that you have. And so the play begins, and let me make this a little bit more visual for you. The play begins with the King of Roussillon and this yellow thing, which looks like a crown. This is supposed to be his ring. His ring gets moved over, and it goes into Helen's hands. So Helen's very happy to receive the ring, but Helen has her mind on other things. She is in love with Bertram. And let me bring this down a little bit over here so you can see Bertram's face. Oops. Okay. And so Helen is in love with Bertram, the character on the left-hand side. There he is right over there. She asks the king if she would tell Bertram, she asks the king if he would tell Bertram to marry her. As a reward, she actually wants the king to use his influence to get Bertram to marry her. Bertram agrees to marry her. They do get married, although Bertram is not too happy with marrying her, but he does agree to the marriage. But he has a stipulation. He doesn't love Helen and he doesn't want to marry her, but because the king tells him to do it, he agrees and they are officially married. Here's Bertram's stipulation. I'll read the lines, and you're not going to see these lines in the movie version, but I'll tell you beforehand because you'll need to know this when you watch the movie. And so here are the lines that Bertram says to Helen. He's got a ring on his finger, which normally should be the wedding ring, right, guys? When two people get married, what does the groom do? He normally gives the bride a ring to put on her finger, and that ring is supposed to be a symbol of their union together. Bertram instead says the following. Can everyone see this? When thou canst get the ring upon my finger, which never shall come off, and show me a child begotten of thy body that I am father to, then call me husband. I'll read it again. When thou canst get the ring upon my finger, which never shall come off, and show me a child begotten of thy body that I am father to, then call me husband. And he puts the stipulation on Diana, and what does he do? He leaves. So he puts two stipulations on her. Number one, he says that I have this ring that's on my finger right now. It's your job. If you can get this ring off my finger, and if you can get pregnant with my child, then I will call you my wife. And the next thing he does after he says that is that he disappears. He puts an impossible condition on her. He puts a stipulation on her which apparently cannot be met. And he obviously does not respect her, even though she's a wife who's worthy of his attention. And so one way to look at this moment in the play is to say that Helen will not be respected as a wife, as an intimate, until she behaves like a stranger. He basically makes her a stranger to him, and he says, okay, act like my intimate, and then and only then will I respect you as my wife. And so let's go back over here to this image. So we're back over here again. So again, what Helen wants is this ring. Does everyone see the blue heart? That's the ring that Helen wants. That's Bertram's ring. It's actually a ring that's a family heirloom. It belongs to his family. This is the ring that Bertram says that Helen has to take from him, even though he's not going to be around. She's got to take that ring off his finger, and she's got to get pregnant by him. Otherwise, he will not accept her. Helen disappears from the picture. It's assumed and presumed that Helen is dead. For all the rumors that are going around is that Helen's out of the picture and that she's dead. After she's gone, Bertram, who, by the way, is still technically speaking married to Helen, finds this other woman named Diana. And this is a picture of Diana over here. You're going to see Bertram's interaction with Diana. And Bertram falls immediately in lust with Diana. He wants to sleep with Diana in the worst possible way. And Diana reminds him that, technically speaking, they don't know for sure if Helen is really dead or not. It's rumored that she's not alive anymore. But wouldn't he be cheating on his wife by having an affair with Diana? And Bertram promises her that if you sleep with me, I will make you my wife. And so he says, sleep with me first, let me get my way with you, and then after you sleep with me, then I'll call you my wife, we'll go and we'll get married. And so this is an instance, obviously, of sexual harassment, sexual coercion. He's trying to get her, he's putting pressure on her, basically, to have sex with him. And as you'll see when I play the video, Diana is in a tough situation. She doesn't want to lose her virginity. She doesn't want to be coerced into having sex with Bertram. Now, unbeknownst to Bertram, Helen is still alive, and Helen actually finds Diana. Helen is sort of moving around in the shadows, and she discovers what Bertram has done. She discovers that Bertram has tried to coerce Diana into having sex with him. And Helen comes to Diana, and Helen proposes a plan that will get Bertram off of Diana's back and will get Helen what she wants. And as you'll see when I unspool the film, the plan is to have Diana agree to sleep with Bertram under two conditions. Number one, that when Diana comes inside Bertram's bedroom, she is going to be veiled, and that the lights must be turned all the way down low, and Bertram can't ask any questions. Those are the conditions under which Diana says, I'll agree to sleep with you. Can you kind of see where this is going? Yeah, kind of, sort of. You're about to see how, where this is all going. And so if you haven't already figured it out, Helen suggests performing a bed trick. And Shakespeare is famous for his bed tricks. There's a bed trick in this play. There's a bed trick in another play called Measure for Measure. And while they're in that bedroom, what do you think happens? It's not Diana who comes into the room, but in fact it is Helen who comes into the room, veiled. Bertram's not allowed to ask any questions. And of course, even before Diana comes into the bedroom, she asks Bertram to prove that he really will marry her. And so what does he do? What do you think he does? He takes that ring, which he wouldn't give to his own wife. And instead, what does he do? Passes it over to Diana. And of course, because Diana and Helen are hatching this plan together, what do you think Diana does with that ring, guys? Passes it over to Helen, right? Now, Helen's finally fulfilled one of the stipulations, right? She's gotten the ring off of Bertram's finger. Now comes the second part of her plan, which is that she's now got two rings, right, everybody? She's got Bertram's ring, and she's got the ring that the king gave to her and said, if you ever need anything from me, this is the proof that you're my best friend. And so what does she ask Diana to do in that darkened bedroom where Bertram's not allowed to ask any questions? She asks Diana to take the king's ring and to put it on Bertram's finger. And so Bertram gets his own ring taken off of his finger, and instead he gets tagged, like a deer would get tagged or an animal out in the wilderness would get tagged by scientists. He gets the king's ring put on his finger. And as you will see when I start playing the movie, the scene begins with Bertram agreeing. Again, the king calls Bertram before him. Helen is assumed to be dead. And the king asks Bertram if he will listen to his instructions this time and instead marry a daughter of another nobleman whose name is Lefeu. I didn't put Lefeu's picture up there because Lefeu is not an important character. It's Bertram's. Bertram now is going to marry. The king suggests that he marry Lefeu's daughter, and Bertram, as the movie begins, Bertram will try to propose marriage to Lefeu's daughter with the ring that he has on his finger. And what ring do you think that is? It's the king's own ring. And so when I start to play the video, that's where the action picks up from. One last thing to say, and then I'll play the video. There's one other character here who I didn't discuss, and that character is this character of Parolus. Now, Parolus is an interesting character, particularly when we're going to talk about harassment and witnesses to harassment. We're going to tie this all back to the idea of who is a bystander or a witness to harassment when it takes place, and who stays quiet, and what will it take for these people who watch harassment take place but don't say or do anything, what will it take for them to come forward? So Parolus is somebody who is an underling to Bertram. In other words, he is a soldier in the army. His superior officer is Bertram, but Parolus does not like Bertram at all. As a matter of fact, he thinks that Bertram is very, very unfair and unjust, and he holds a very low opinion of Bertram. But again, Bertram is his boss. And are you going to talk back to your boss? Are you going to question your boss? Or are you just going to keep quiet and just follow instructions? And that's what Bertram does for most of the play. And what does Bertram do? He asks Parolus to take letters back and forth between him and Diana. So while Bertram is wooing Diana, he's using Parolus in order to act as a go-between, as a messenger, to go back and forth. And so Parolus is very well aware of the fact that Bertram has had his eyes on Diana, and Parolus is a kind of a witness. Okay? So all of this is basically what you need to know. I think that we're ready to roll the film. As you're watching the film, I want you to think about a couple of questions. So how does any of this have to do with discrimination and harassment in the workplace today? So I've made up a list of three things that I want everyone to keep track of, pay attention to, write it down, tweet about it if you like. Can everyone hear?
Can you hear me? Yeah? Okay. So here are three questions, and I'm going to put it up over here. I'll put it up on the chair over here, that I want everyone to think about as I run the film for you. So I want you to pay attention to moments or instances in the movie when male authority figures who claim to respect women actually act in their own self-interest. Can you identify where those moments are in the film? Moments when male authority figures who claim to respect women actually act in their own self-interest. So if you can note that and take note of that during the Q&A session, I'll ask a couple of people maybe to share when those moments have occurred in the movie. The second thing, which is in red, is I want you to note instances when there were safe spaces that were created for witnesses to not only find one another, but also to speak up. What instances did you find where there was a safe space where somebody who was a witness to an act of sexual harassment was able to interact safely with one another and to work together, to collaborate together in order to fight against harassment? That's the second thing I want you to be aware of. The third thing I want you to be aware of is I want you to think about the power of anonymity. And you kind of already kind of sense where the play is going with this. Obviously, Diana is going to be veiled, right? Think about what Shakespeare is saying about the power of anonymity. The power of anonymity to empower victims of harassment and actually to even help the harassers to recognize their own blind spots. How does the play ask us to think about the power of anonymity? And what kind of power of anonymity do we have today? Do we have anything available to us that can help us to make it easier for victims to speak out and for witnesses to speak out against harassers? So I want you to keep all these questions in mind as I play the film for you. I'm going to put the questions right over here, so if you would like to refer back to them as the movie is playing, oops, I got over here. You can refer to this as the movie is playing. And I'm gonna start playing the movie. The movie's about 17 minutes long, and again, note specific moments in the movie that you think correspond to these three things, because we'll circle back to the question of harassment in the workplace in 2022 after we see the movie, and we'll see if we can make some connections between the movie and our workplace today. So let me start playing. All righty. Here we go. All's well that ends well. I'm gonna be showing you two scenes. One from Act 4 and one from Act 5. The first scene is the scene of Bertram trying to get Diana to sleep with him.
Give me that ring.
I'll lend it thee, my dear, but have no power to give it from me.
Will you not, my lord?
It is an honor longing to our house, bequeathed down from many ancestors, which were the greatest obloquy in the world of me to lose.
Mine honor such a ring. My chastity is the jewel of our house, bequeathed down from many ancestors, which were the greatest obloquy of the world in me to lose.
Here, take my ring. My house, mine honor, yea, my life be thine, and I'll forbid by thee.
When midnight comes, knock at my chamber window. I'll order take, my mother shall not hear. Now will I charge you in the band of truth. When you have conquered my yet maiden bed, remain there but an hour, nor speak to me. My reasons are most strong, and you shall know them when back again this ring shall be delivered. And on your finger in the night I'll put another ring, that what in time proceeds may token to the future our past deeds. Adieu. Till then, fail not. You have won a wife of me, though there my hope be done.
A heaven on earth I have won by thee.
For which live long to thank both heaven and me. You may so in the end. My mother told me just how he would woo, as if she sat in his heart. She says all men have the like oaths. He had sworn to marry me when his wife's dead. Therefore, I'll lie with him when I am buried. Only in this disguise, I think no sin to cozen him that would unjustly win.
So did everyone understand what happened over there? Basically, she's able to get the ring from him. She's basically able to get the ring that he wouldn't give to Helen off of his finger because he'd rather sleep with somebody who basically he treats like a prostitute rather than to give that ring to his wedded wife. That's what kind of person Bertram is. Here comes the bed trick, okay, everybody? So let me play that for you as well. See the switch? Who does he think he's going to sleep with? Diana. And who is he actually about to sleep with? His wife. Okay, and so the next scene will be in the court. And Bertram will be summoned. As I said, Bertram will be summoned by the king to propose marriage to LeFou's daughter. And just as Bertram is giving the ring to LeFou's daughter to begin a new marriage, there'll be a new person who enters the court. And who do you think that new person will be? It'll be Diana, the very same Diana that he thought he had just slept with. Right, guys, everybody? And so pay attention to what happens in this scene between the king, Bertram, and Diana, okay? Remember, Bertram thinks that he slept with Diana, okay? And he's about to get very confused in a few minutes about what actually happened in that darkened bedroom. Things are about to get very confusing. Again, keep in mind the power of anonymity. We're going to get back to that issue again.
Hair that's on it. Helen that's dead was a sweet creature. Such a ring as this I saw upon her finger the last time I took her to court.
Hers it was not.
Now pray you, let me see it.
And so, LeFou, played by the other guy in the checkered shirt, notices that the ring that Bertram is giving in order to ask for his daughter's hand in marriage is a ring that he's seen before. It's a familiar ring. And guess who's about to look at that ring very closely? It's the king. Do you think the king is going to recognize his own ring? And then things get really complicated.
For mine eye, while I was speaking, oft was fastened to it. This ring was mine. And when I gave it Helen, I bade her, if her fortunes ever stood necessity to help, that by this token I would relieve her. Had you that craft to reave her of what should stead her most?
My gracious sovereign, however it pleases you to take it so, the ring was never hers.
I'm sure I saw her wear it.
You are deceived, my lord. She never saw it. In Florence was it from a casement thrown me, wrapped in a paper that did contain the name of her that threw it. Noble she was, and thought I stood engaged. But when I had subscribed to mine own honor and informed her fully I could not answer in that course of honor as she had made the overture, she ceased in heavy satisfaction and would never take the ring again.
'Twas mine, 'twas Helen's, whoever gave it you. Then if you know that you are well acquainted with yourself, confess 'twas hers, and by what rough enforcement you got it from her. She called the saints to surety that she would never put it from her finger unless she gave it to yourself in bed, where you have never come, or sent it us by her great disaster.
She never saw it.
Thou speakest it falsely, as I do love mine honor. And makes conjectural fear come into me, which I would fain shut out.
So one more added detail, which is that Helen has said the only time that she'll ever take off that ring which the king gave to her would be to put on the finger of her husband, right? And so now Bertram's really confused. How the heck did I get this ring on my finger? Right, guys? The confusion is starting to set in. He's already made up one lie about how he got the ring. Somebody threw it at him. Some woman who was pursuing him threw it at him out of a window. So he's made up one lie to try and account for that ring, his possession of that ring. And now he's going to be, you'll see the expression on his face and how he's starting to get confused about, wait a minute, how did I end up with the king's ring? Let's keep playing.
If it should prove that thou art so inhuman, will not prove so. And yet I know not. Thou didst hate her deadly. And she is dead, which nothing but to close her eyes myself could win me to believe more than to see this ring. Take him away. Away with him. We'll sift this matter further.
If you shall prove the ring was ever hers, you shall as easy prove that I husbanded her bed in Florence, where yet she never was!
Okay, he just said some important lines. So important, in fact, that I'm going to show it to you on the screen. Did anyone catch what he just said? He made a very, very important statement, and I'll put it up on the screen. You already saw these lines that Bertram gave to Diana. Remember these lines? Here, take my ring, my house, mine honor. Yea, my life be thine, and I'll be bid by thee. And the king, later on in Act 5, which is what we're going to see over here, the king says to him, she hath that ring of yours. He's going to say, I think she has. These lines haven't come up yet. But basically he says, Bertram says to the king, if you can prove that this ring was placed on my finger, you can just as easily prove that I slept with my wife. He puts the credit on the proof for accepting the fact that he actually did end up sleeping with his wife. This is going to be an important point. Let's go back over here again.
I'm racked in dismal thinkings.
Gracious sovereign, here's a petition from a Florentine. Her business looks in her with an importing visage, and she told me in a sweet verbal brief it did concern your highness with herself.
Upon his many protestations to marry me when his wife was dead, I blush to say it, he won me. Now is the Count Roussillon a widower. He stole from Florence, taking no leave, and I follow him to his country for justice. Grant it me, O king, in you it best lies, otherwise a seducer flourishes, and a poor maid is undone. Diana Capulet. Seek these suitors, and bring again the Count! I am afeard the life of Helen, friends, was foully snatched. I wonder, sir, sit wives are monsters to you, and that you fly them as you swear them lordship, yet you desire to marry. What woman's that?
I am, my lord, a wretched Florentine, derived from the ancient Capulet. My suit, as I do understand, you know.
Come hither, Count. You know this woman?
My lord, I neither can nor will deny but that I know her. Does she accuse me further?
Why do you look so strange upon your wife?
She's none of mine, my lord.
If you shall marry, you give away this hand, and that is mine. You give away heaven's vows, and those are mine. You give away myself, which is known mine. For I, by vow, am so embodied yours that she which marries you must marry me, either both or none.
My lord, this is a fond and desperate creature whom sometime I have laughed with. Let your highness lay a more noble thought upon mine honor than for to think that I would sink it here.
Sir, for my thoughts you have them ill to friend till your deeds gain them.
Good, my lord. Ask him upon his oath if he does think he had not my virginity.
What sayest thou to her?
She's impudent, my lord, and was a common gangster to the camp.
He does me wrong, my lord. Behold this ring, whose high respect and rich validity did lack a parallel. Yet for all that, he gave it to a commoner of the camp, if I be one.
Methought you said you saw one here in court could witness it.
I did, my lord, but loath am to produce so bad an instrument. His name's Paroles.
I saw...
Before we go to Paroles, notice that she produces a ring that proves that Bertram was in bed with her. And of course, which ring is that, everybody? His heirloom ring, right? The one that he said that he would never give to Helen. And of course, she's using that as evidence that he has been with her. So this is going to be important as well. What do you think Bertram is thinking while all this is going on? He's making up excuses, right? He pursued her. You saw how ardently he wanted to sleep with her. And meanwhile, what is he accused her of? He's accused her of being a common gamester of the camp. He's accused her of being a whore. He slept with this whore. She got a ring out of him, and now she wants to claim that he's married to her and he owes her something. Again, sexual harassment, right? Discrimination, right? How are these women setting him up to realize what he's doing? Keep that in mind. Keep that question in mind.
I saw the man today, if man he be.
Find him and bring him hither.
What of him? He's quoted for a most perfidious slave. Am I or that or this for what he'll utter that will speak anything?
She hath that ring of yours.
I think she has. Certain it is I liked her and boarded her in the wanton way of youth. She knew her distance and did angle for me, matting my eagerness with her restraint, as all impediments in fancy's course or motives of more fancy, and in fine, her infinite cunning with her modern grace subdued me to her rate. She got the ring, and I had that which any inferior might at market price have bought.
I must be patient. You, that have turned off a first so noble wife, may justly die at me. I pray you yet, since you lack virtue, I will lose a husband. Send for your ring. I will return it home, and give me mine again.
I have it not.
What ring was yours, I pray you?
Sir, much like the same upon your finger.
Know you this ring? This ring was his of late.
And this was it I gave him, being abed.
The story then goes false. You threw it him out of a casement.
I have spoke the truth.
My lord, I do confess the ring was hers.
You boggle shrewdly, and every feather starts you. Is this the man you speak of?
Aye, my lord.
Tell me, sirrah, but tell me true, I charge you, not fearing the displeasure of your master, by him and by this woman here, what know you?
So again, this is an important moment as well. Remember, Paroles doesn't like
Bertram very much, and he's been taking letters back and forth between Bertram and Diana. Now, for the very first time, who is Perillus answerable to? Is he answerable to Bertram, or is he answerable to a higher authority than even Bertram? Keep that in mind as well, the ability to leverage authority. How can women leverage higher authorities against lower authorities to root out harassment, to root out discrimination? I'll even show you the lines that are said over here. These are Bertram's lines to the king. If you shall prove this ring was ever hers, you shall as easily prove that I husbanded her bed in Florence, where yet she never was. So he basically earlier on said, if you can prove that this ring was Helen's ring, then I'll admit that I actually slept with my wife. And then the king, the line that you just read, tell me, sirrah, but tell me true. I charge you, not fearing the displeasure of your master. In other words, here's the king offering his protection for speaking out. Not fearing the displeasure of your master, which on your just proceeding I'll keep off. The king promises him, I'll give you protection. Speak by him and by this woman here, what know you? And Perillus speaks.
So please, your majesty, my master hath been an honorable gentleman. Trick seeth that in him which gentlemen have.
Come to the purpose. Did he love her?
Faith, sir, he did love her, but how?
How, I pray you?
He did love her, sir, as a gentleman loves a woman.
How is that?
He loved her, sir, and loved her not.
As thou art a knave, and no knave, what an equivocal companion is this!
I am a poor man, and at your majesty's command.
He's a good drum, my lord, but a naughty order.
Do you know he promised me marriage?
Faith, I know more than I'll speak.
But wilt thou not speak all thou knowest?
Yes, so please, your majesty. I did go between them, as I said, but more than that, he loved her, for indeed he was mad for her, and talked of Satan, and of limbo, and of furies, and I know not what, yet I was in that credit with them at that time that I knew of their going to bed, and of other motions, as promising her marriage, and things which would derive me ill will to speak of, therefore I will not speak what I know.
Thou hast spoken all already. Unless thou...
And so, did everyone see Bertram's reaction, as Perillus said? Oh yeah, he chased her. He chased her hard. He really wanted her badly. What has Perillus been doing? He's been blowing the whistle on Bertram, right? Bertram can't say that he didn't like Diana, he didn't know Diana, that he got the ring from someone else. It's Perillus who's basically been conscripted by Diana and Helen, by Helen specifically, right, in order to blow the whistle, knowing that the king is right there and Bertram can't do anything against him. So keep that in mind. Keep that in mind for our own situation today.
Unless thou can say they are married, but thou art too fine in thy evidence. Therefore, stand aside. This ring, you say, was yours.
Aye, my good lord.
Where did you buy it? Or who gave it you?
It was not given me, nor I did not buy it.
Who lent it you?
It was not lent me, neither.
Where did you find it, then?
I found it not.
If it were yours by none of all these ways, how could you give it him?
I never gave it him.
My lord, this woman's an easy glove. She goes off and on at pleasure.
This ring was mine. I gave it his first wife.
It might be yours or hers, for aught I know.
Take her away. I do not like her now. To prison with her, and away with him! Unless thou tell'st me where thou hadst this ring, thou diest within this hour.
I'll never tell you.
Take her away!
I'll put in bail, my liege.
I think thee now some common customer.
By Jove, if ever I knew man, 'twas you!
Wherefore hadst thou accused him all this while?
Because he's guilty, and he is not guilty. He knows I am no maid, and he'll swear to it. I'll swear I am a maid, and he knows not. Great king, I am no strumpet by my life. I am either maid or else this old man's wife.
She does abuse our ears. To prison with her.
Fetch my bail. Stay, royal sir. The jeweler that owes the ring is sent for and shall surety me. But for this lord, who hath abused me, as he knows himself, though yet he never harmed me, here I quit him. He knows himself my bed he hath defiled, and at that time he got his wife with child. Dead though she be, she feels her young one kick. So there's my riddle. One that's dead is quick. And now, behold the meaning.
Is there no exorcist beguiles the truer office of mine eyes? Is it real that I see?
No, my good lord. 'Tis but the shadow of a wife you see. The name and not the thing.
Both. Oh, pardon.
Oh, my good lord. When I was like this maid, I found you wondrous kind. There's your ring. And look you, here's your letter. This it says, when from my finger you can get this ring, and are by me with child, etc. This is done. Will you be mine, now you are doubly won?
If she, my liege, can make me know this clearly, I'll love her dearly. Ever, ever dearly.
If it appear not plain and prove untrue, deadly divorce step between me and you.
Let us from point to point this story know, to make the even truth in pleasure flow. If thou be'st yet a fresh uncropped flower, choose thou thy husband, and I'll pay thy dower. For I can guess that by thy honest aid, thou keep'st a wife herself, thyself a maid. Of that and all the progress, more or less, resolvedly more leisure shall express. All yet seems well, and if it ends so neat, the bitter past, more welcome is the sweet.
Anyone in the back can help us with the lights, that'd be great. So what did you guys think? What happened over here? Let's look at some of these issues that we talked about over here. Let's talk about some of the things that you noticed about the bed trick and what happened, and what kind of analogs we can make between this obviously fighting harassment and discrimination in today's world. So first of all, let's talk a little bit about the power of, the issue of male authority over here. So let's open that one up over here. Male authority figures who claim to respect women but only act in their own self-interest. Can you think of any situation today where men claim that they are really looking after women and their interests, particularly in corporate America, but in fact, they are not? They claim that they are trying to find a more equitable, just workplace, hiring practices, and so on, but in fact, they are not actually doing that. Can anyone think of a scenario like that, a situation like that?
Sorry about that. Yeah, please, come on up. This microphone is on right now. So any analogs between what you've seen and our own world today? Go ahead. And tell us your name as well. It should be on. Is it not on? It's okay. No, I'm sorry. Let's see over here. Should be on. Okay. All right, we can use this one.
Oh, okay. Hello. I'm Madison. I think I can draw a lot of comparisons to a lot of the stuff that happens today with, funny enough, game culture and the company Blizzard. They've been under a lot of scandal for not standing up for their female employees and having a pro-bro frat culture and putting a lot of women at risk, and a lot of women have been infected and impacted by this, and their lives have been ruined, and it's led to a walkout, and the people at Blizzard claim that they care about female empowerment and female diversity, and they have all these female characters that are strong and they support female rights, but in reality, they're only filling their pockets and they only want the customers to keep buying their games because they just really don't care.
Thank you. That's a great comment. I mean, we see this all the time, right? This kind of token gesture towards making sure that you have women on the workforce. And these are really, very often they are token gestures. Just as Bertram is trying to show respect and promising to make Diana his wife if only she'll give in to his demands. And then at the very end, once he thinks he's had sex with her, he calls her a strumpet, he calls her a whore, right? Once he's gotten what he wants, he basically dismisses her, right? Not that unfamiliar with what's going on today. If you analyze it to the corporate culture, Madison is exactly right. How different is that from what happens in the corporate culture today? Let me share with you a little statistic that I have over here. I'll make it a little bit bigger. According to a study by the McKinsey Report, it's quite a famous report, it projects that in a full potential scenario in which women participate in the economy identically to men, $28 trillion, 26% would be added to the annual global GDP when compared to the current business as usual scenario. So in other words, why are more women hired? They're hired because of this potential, right? Because if you were to maximize the number of qualified women that were out there and you were to give them opportunities and promote them within your company, what would it do to the bottom line of a company like Blizzard, for instance? It would actually serve the interest of the authority figures. It would make them a lot of money, right? So although it's in their interest to get the most out of their employees and to give qualified female employees a chance to walk through the door and to rise up the ladder, to ascend the ladder, in numbers, in hard numbers alone, it makes a huge, huge difference, right? How much our country could benefit. But nevertheless, these are all token gestures, right? And in part, it may have to do with that meritocracy, right? There may not even be a logical reason for it. It just may be the fact that the people who are responsible for making these decisions cannot see past their own biases, right? They're perfectly satisfied fulfilling quotas, but when it comes to making real change and giving real opportunity, it's all lip service. So that's a very, very good point that you just made, Madison. Let's think about the next point, which is about the power of anonymity, and we'll think about that one as well. The power of anonymity to empower victims of discrimination, harassment, and also to help harassers to recognize their own blind spots. So let me ask another person maybe to come up to the microphone. How can we, in 2022, the way they use the power of anonymity obviously was through the veil, right? Bertram did not know that he was sleeping with his wife. And they used the veil to actually get him to do the right thing, which was not to sleep with a stranger, but to sleep with the woman that he had promised marriage to, right? And so anonymity in Shakespeare's play was used to get the man to do what his responsibilities are, right? How, in what ways today in 2022 can we harness the power of anonymity, particularly the power of anonymity provided by the internet, to help women get more of a voice, not only in society in general, but also in the corporate culture, getting them hired, getting their grievances aired if they have grievances. In what ways do you think we can use the internet? Any ideas about that, about how we can use the power of anonymity, the power of the internet, in order to have more equity, more equality? Any thoughts about that? Anybody have any ideas about that? The internet certainly allows a lot of anonymity, doesn't it? Right, guys? How can we use the power of the internet, the power of the anonymity created on the internet, maybe to create more opportunities or to give voice to the people who perhaps would be afraid to speak? Yeah, Professor Malloy has got some thoughts about that. So, yeah, let me actually hand you the microphone because we're actually recording today's event. So unless you've got a mic in front, it's not gonna show up. Yeah.
Thank you. I mean, this doesn't have to do with the sort of hiring practices, but rather when you said about the internet and everything, and the Me Too movement was a big part of that, I want to say 4 years ago, and how it gave voice to women and it gave them sort of not just a voice, but just the feeling to be okay to speak up. Yeah. That's one way. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah.
Other thoughts? How can we use the power of the internet, particularly the anonymity that's granted by the internet, to empower people who don't have a voice? Yes, what's your name?
My name's Yash, and so one way I would say to keep anonymity consistent would be private forums. Say if you're hired in a workplace, they would have a mutual forum, like we have the student feed in our college, but the college has everyone's names on it. Rather having the names on it, just don't have any names whatsoever. If in a workplace, every employee of, say, that department or every employee whatsoever could speak up on things that are going around. And if not everyone, I'm sure that not everyone uses the college's app, but some people do. And if enough people like have eyes on a certain thing, eventually there's a hierarchy where someone would say something to someone that needs to listen to this, and eventually things come out.
Do you all feel that if more people could speak out without having their identities known, there would be more instances of discrimination and harassment being reported? What do you guys think? I'm getting a whole bunch of nods, yes. I saw somebody else who wanted to say something. Who was it? Yeah, good.
I was gonna say before, like how we met Annie, like how we mentioned, like one of the biggest struggles for women is like they're afraid to speak out or be labeled as difficult, and a lot of times of like workplace harassment, like it's a power struggle and they're afraid to speak out because the person has power or is like their boss or manager. And like by having like online anonymity, yeah, they're allowed to speak out without like in fear of getting like their job taken away. And it's like seen through like celebrities when there's a power struggle and people are afraid to speak out because that person is like held in a higher regard than them. Like they're allowed to speak out on the internet and like have people listen to them without like being afraid of that person doing something.
As a matter of fact, just to piggyback off of Annie's comment, Hulu had a great series a few years ago called Let's Keep This Between Us, which was all about harassment on college and high school campuses. And they, the people who made this documentary actually put an Instagram post out asking if any woman had been harassed by her high school teacher or her college professor. And it was entirely an anonymous process. And over the course of several weeks, because it was anonymous, thousands and thousands of women reported having been sexually either harassed or outright assaulted by their male teachers, right? And there was one comment that would appear over and over again on Instagram, and that comment was, "I'm so relieved that somebody is willing to listen to me." And there was it was a common refrain that was repeated over and over again. It may not make any difference, but at least it helps to know that someone is willing to listen. And so the idea of allowing anonymity and also allowing a safe space as well, right, which is the other thing that I ask you to think about. The idea of creating a safe space may be the way, right? In what ways can we use the power of the internet to create safe spaces? In what ways can we use the power of anonymity that the internet gives us in order to have some of the same results that Helen and Diana were able to have, right? They used the power of anonymity. They actually got Bertram to kind of understand that what he was doing to Diana was done to him, right? Because how was he treating Diana? He was treating Diana as just a body, right, guys? He was just treating her as a body. And of course, when he realizes that someone took his family heirloom ring off his finger and someone did it in the bedroom and he has no idea who did it in the bedroom, how do you think Bertram felt at that moment? He had been treating her as just a piece of flesh. How do you think Bertram felt when he realized somebody took this ring off my finger and I'm not quite sure who it was who took this ring off? How do you think Bertram was feeling in that moment? What do you guys think? Abused, right? How does it feel to be raped? Well, maybe Bertram, right? Maybe Bertram got a taste of that, right, guys? What is rape? Rape is when someone has sex with you without your knowledge, well, without your permission, in some cases without your knowledge as well, right, if you're drugged. But is it possible that one reason why Bertram's got that big change of heart by the end of the play, and again, it's fiction, right? So we don't necessarily have to hold it to the same accountability as we do in real life. But there is that point that Shakespeare wants to make, which is that how does it feel to have someone get access to your body without your permission, right? Bertram gets a taste of that, doesn't he, right?
He said confused.
Confused.
Yeah,
very confused.
He's not really a likable character.
No. Not at all, and perhaps even used as well, not just confused, but also used as well, right? And he even actually comes out and says that if you can prove that this ring was taken off my finger, you know, you can prove that she was actually in bed with me. Let me give you a couple of more statistics, and we actually are just almost out of time over here. I have a question, and this is the last thing we'll ask. How many of you think, since we talked about the hiring practices, how many of you think that if the job hiring practice for sending out resumes and interviewing candidates was made anonymous so that employers didn't see the names and addresses and any of that vital information about their potential employees? How many of you feel that process would be more beneficial to women than to men? All right, I'm getting a whole bunch of hands going up. Could we use the power of anonymity on the internet to make the process of applying for jobs more anonymous, so that a person who's qualified for a job would likely be considered worthy of being interviewed? And of course, there are anonymous ways to interview as well, right? It only goes so far. At some point, you've got to sit down for a face-to-face. But even the power of anonymity has been practiced. And let me just give you two examples, and then I'll let you go. I realize we're out of time over here. But let me show you what happened. They did a study at NASA, where they made the application process for a scientist to work on the Hubble telescope an entirely anonymous process. And you know what they found? They found that the number of applicants coming in, the number of women who were applying for the job increased, the number of women who were considered for the position increased, and the number of women who were hired increased. They all those numbers went up. And so consider all of these issues. The issue of creating a safe space, the issue of anonymity, the issue of empowering people to feel like they are empowered as witnesses, as Perolus was, right? Once he realized that I'm going to be protected if I speak up, how can we create circumstances? How can we create conditions like this through message boards, through various sites? So anyway, that hour and 15 minutes flew by. Thank you very, very much. I have one prize to give out. A couple of you asked some very nice questions. Let's see, who shall we give our prize to? I think we will, shall we give it to our, yeah, right over here?
Yes.
Okay, yes, okay. Annie, come on up here. All right, let's give her a hand. All righty, so we are out of time, but Annie's prize will actually be from the play that you just saw. So you'll recognize this from the play. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming.